Good morning, everyone, and welcome back. It's my pleasure to introduce Marshalette. Marshalette Wise has a BA in English Language Arts Education from Tuskegee University, a Master's of Education in Educational Leadership from the University of Minnesota, and a CELTA certificate from Teaching House, New York City. She has taught as a certified teacher in American public schools for 4 years, taught in South Korea for 2 years, and this is her second year in Saudi Arabia. She has also been the founding director of a nonprofit organization, Wise Scholars Foundation, since 2005. It assists at-risk students with school completion and college recruitment. Thank you and welcome, Marshalette.
So today we're going to talk about classroom management, okay? Let's start off and I'm going to ask each of you something about your student. Tell me their age. You can just scream it out.
17, 18, 19,
20.
Okay, gender.
Female.
Nationality.
South.
What's their major?
It's
medical engineering.
Okay, their level.
Intermediate.
Okay, now I want you to really tell me something about your students. The first ones, I think most teachers know those and they're quite simple, but I want you to really share something about your students with me. Tell me one of your students' hopes, dreams, or goals.
Get married.
Be an engineer.
Travel the world.
Travel the world.
They're very motivated, I feel. They care a lot about their grades.
Okay.
Go to school in the U.S.
Going to school in the U.S. Okay. Tell me one of your students' fears or setbacks.
Not making the program.
Not getting the major they want.
Getting a B.
Getting lower.
Getting something less than 100%.
Not having a family member to travel with.
Okay. All right. Tell me their scariest moment.
Media cast.
Some of them is getting up and speaking in front of the entire class.
Their funniest moment.
The facial expressions. I find the facial expressions.
No, not from what you think is funny, but theirs. Their funniest moment ever.
Okay.
What about their greatest lesson learned? Anything else? What about their family? Tell me something about their family.
Strong family ties. Yeah. Lots of siblings.
Very connected.
Okay.
Father will sit down.
Well, today we are all here to learn from one another. We are all equals in the quest to become the best teachers that we can. And there is a long ways I have to go before I master this skill, but I have come a long ways when I started as a public school teacher those 4 years in America. And I wasn't always a good teacher. I was very tough on my students. I felt as though I wanted complete silence in the classroom, all chairs facing the same way. Any deviation from my rules may cause them to get suspended, reprimanded, parents called to the school. That style only worked for so long until I realized I was having classroom management problems. It seemed neither my students nor myself were really enjoying the learning process. I left work feeling like this literally every day. It wasn't fun going into the classroom. I would leave work. Sometimes I would dread to go back the next day. It was during this time that I contemplated leaving the teaching profession. I asked myself, maybe this teaching is just not for you. Maybe you're just not cut out for it. After my pity party with myself, I reevaluated why I chose to major in English or to get a master's in education. And I realized that I liked teaching. I just hadn't learned the basics to get me through the biggest challenges we face sometimes, which is classroom management. That if I could do that, I think that I will enjoy it more. So I thought back to some of my favorite teachers, and one lady in particular came to mind. She's dead now, Mrs. J.C. Johnson. And I thought about how good she made us feel to come into her classroom, how she always smiled at us, how she cared about us, how she bonded with us, how she knew if one of us was absent, wanted to know always, do you have a problem? How she made us feel that we thought of her all as children, even in college, and even now as I speak about her, I still have that admiration for her because she was a good teacher. She didn't rule with an iron fist, but we respected her for some reason. And I wanted to try to learn whatever she was doing, I wanted to do the same thing. So, I read a quote, a man or woman must be big enough to admit his mistakes, smart enough to profit from them, and strong enough to correct them. And I realized that I needed to reapproach my teaching and classroom management. They say students never forget a teacher, no matter how bad or good they are. And I pondered if my prior students would remember me in a positive light, and I fear that they may not. So I sought to change that from that step forward, and hopefully all my other students will remember me. Positive life. So I said to myself, what am I doing wrong? I then faced it and pulled myself up by my bootstraps. So following is a 5-part presentation on the things that I think makes a recipe for good classroom management. These are things that I've learned. So part one, a teacher of 20 years named Lee said, one of the most effective classroom management strategies is to get to know your students outside the classroom. Building up a personal relationship with students, getting to know them as people, has paid big in class when it comes to reducing negative behavior. Let's talk about the value of getting to know our students. Because sometimes you just come in to teach, but what do you know about them, what they bring to the classroom with them every day? Students who feel that their teacher genuinely cares for them are motivated to do better in school. Building a sense of community is key to creating an environment that is comfortable and conducive to learning. Having a good classroom community not only helps in having a smoothly managed classroom, but also builds interpersonal skills in the students. Teachers who communicate effectively with their students and provide helpful feedback have a better atmosphere for a learning environment. Building a positive relationship with the students early on will allow the teacher to meet his or her goals and have a successful school year. And each student has something exceptional and personal to offer. Focus on their individuality and special talents. You never know how they can positively contribute to the group. Now, some ways to get to know your students, because this is about classroom management and it's 5 parts, and my first one is getting to know your students personally, as people, okay? So ways to do that. Have students do class presentations and write assignments. You can learn a lot about them through those two methods. Engage students in conversations and discussions. Be genuinely interested in them, especially when they talk about their lives and/or preferences. Keep an open communication. Be approachable. Teacher and student must work as a team, not you as their dictator. Don't just present the lessons, but also be mentors, facilitators, and guides. Connect things you've learned about your students to their current learning, the unit topics, and their assignments. and connect with them individually as well as the group and learn their names. I cannot stress that. I think that's very important. At least make an attempt. Let them know it's a priority to you. And try from the first day forward. Okay, you're too quiet. Prize time. Who wants a prize? Raise your hand if you want a prize. And this prize, very expensive. This is like some of the best of the best. Okay? So I want you to put on your listening ears, okay? And listen for the main idea. I don't think it can play here, which is, oh, look here. All right. Ready? Let's listen for the main idea. You can do it.
Dal punto di vista legale, voi, sia pure per ignoranza, parliamoci chiaro, avete commesso una frode. Articolo 101. Matrimonio in imminente pericolo di vita. Nel caso di imminente pericolo di vita, eccetera, eccetera. Spero tutte le modalità. Ma l'imminente pericolo di vita non c'è stato, perché la vostra, cara signorina, è stata una finzione.
Chi sta di Redmond? Alfredo, Lucia, Rosalina. A te del prete, se ne è andato, se è alzata dal letto e mi ha detto, tu mi. Siamo lì?
Okay, play it one more time. Yeah. Make sure you listen carefully this time. Okay. Okay. Let's see. Would that make
a subtext?
Yeah, with subtext. Yeah, now you should
make a now, who can tell me the main idea of this?
Matrimonial in Italy.
Marriage in Italy?
There's
a
whole
matrimonio.
This lady's got a problem.
Yeah, she's
okay. But my point of this activity, if I really wanted you to tell me the main idea, I would have played it in English. It's for you to come to my second stage of classroom management, humbling yourself and understand the challenges facing ESL EFLs. Sometimes we get lost and think, oh, you don't speak English and get frustrated. But was that easy for you to tell me the main idea? Now, can you imagine an hour and 30 minutes of that intense to follow? So put yourself in their place sometimes also. This is your student's second language, some third. They are already fluent in their mother tongue. There is a difference between a student who does not speak English and a student who is illiterate in his or her native language. Regardless of intrinsic or extrinsic motivations, many of these students in Saudi Arabia have to excel in English to get into their majors. And they are struggling to maintain their culture, their native language, and identity while embracing the learning of English. Okay. Part three, we're going to have the beautiful Christina to come up. And classroom management also starts before even entering the classroom. It starts with lesson planning also, and that's part three. So we talked about getting to know your students. Part two was understand the challenges that they face. Now you're ready. Now, before you even enter the classroom, and we're going to get to that, at home, you need to plan your lesson. This allows no room for the students to slack off in the classroom. And Christina will come up and tell you all about it. She taught in Germany for 7 years and Saudi Arabia for 4 years.
Just to clarify, I'm no expert at this, but Marshalette decided that I needed to help her, so please bear with me. I also want to say that teaching in Germany for 7 years was very interesting because I was teaching exceptionally educated people, mainly from universities that were trying to better their English. But I also experienced what it was like to be on the other side and to sit through German lessons to try and perfect my own German. Because, as you all know, my husband is German. My children speak German, so it was necessary for me to feel part of the German side of things. And it's
soul destroying. Leaving a class, not understanding anything. So I do understand how these students sometimes feel when, you know, you are just absolutely overwhelmed. And then you're in a situation, sort of like a supermarket or anywhere, a social situation, and everybody around you is laughing, sharing jokes, chatting away, and you feel so stupid. It's the most humbling experience, it really is. But it took me 7 years, finally learned the language. I'm not an expert, my grammar is shocking, but thank goodness I can laugh along with their jokes. Anyway, right, a lesson plan. I do believe that I'm probably going to repeat what Jasia has already said for lesson planning, so I'm going to make it short. I did want to just add one or two things. From experience, when you are planning a lesson, it helps a lot of the time to bring a little bit more information to the table as opposed to just what is in the book. The students we are teaching, and I found especially the classes that we've taught, they are such bright girls. And they have so much to offer. And I found it very rewarding when I could put a topic out there and hands would go up in excitement. And they always invariably had something interesting to say and add and contribute. So I think when planning a lesson, look at what you're going to be teaching them, but find something else interesting related to the topic. It brings so much more out there. So, okay, let me not get sidetracked.
How about go next?
Okay, preparing your lessons. Allow no room to slack off. I know this is sometimes a bit unreasonable to expect. Our students love to sort of chat for a little bit. You need to give them these opportunities as well. But basically, to try and have a lesson plan that covers the entire lesson, but to also not feel that should something digress or should something change or if you run out of time, don't feel bad. These things happen. Okay, so what do I want students to learn? When planning, decide what you want them to take away at the end of the lesson. What teaching and learning activities will I use? Now, I believe that Miss Alexis, behind the Apple iPad, is going to be doing a presentation on activities. Looking forward to that. How will I check for understanding? How will you look at what you've taught your students and how they take it away and understand what you've given them? Because, of course, what's the point in teaching and teaching and teaching and they still have no idea what you're talking about? A good method to see what you've given them as your gift of teaching is to actually have them at the end of a lesson write little notes, little pieces of paper to say, this is what I understood, this is what we did in the lesson. See it from their point of view. I think it also gives you a better idea of how they are interpreting what you are teaching. Because sometimes we can teach and teach and teach, but then they understand it completely differently. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't know. Like I said, I'm not an expert, so. Okay. The way I see a lesson plan is an instructor's roadmap. Now, we all know we need maps to get from A to B. Men clearly don't need maps, but we as women do. However, so see that's your instructor's roadmap. A successful lesson plan addresses and integrates these three key components. Objectives for student learning, teaching and learning activities, strategies to check student understanding, which I think is inevitably the most important. Right. Steps for preparing a lesson plan. Outline learning objectives. What are you going to be teaching them? Heading. Titles, main ideas. Exactly how we teach our students when we are teaching them writing. What are the main ideas? Develop the introduction. Now this is where I think is a very important aspect. And I found in my experience, when I did this, the interest in the classroom peaked a lot more. Instead of them just looking at the textbooks,
and me going wah-wah, because that's what it sounds like. You bring something in, a personal anecdote, something that they can relate to. Tell them something funny. Students love humor. Obviously, we have to be culturally sensitive, but it's perfectly simple and easy to do. Historical event. Thought-provoking dilemma. What would you do, ladies, if you were able to do this? Or, you know, the whole technology thing. Imagine a world without cell phones. Now, we all know that they are attached to the hip. A real-world example. What is going on in the world today? Sometimes it's okay to bring in something political. They're very aware of what's going on. And I prefer to treat them like adults who are reading the news, rather than pushing things under the carpet and pretending that these issues don't exist. And one of our students actually wrote an essay about the problem in Syria and how it made her feel. And she has friends there. And it was beautifully done, and she started crying, but all the students were very involved in her emotions, and it was lovely. It pulled the class together, and then we had a discussion, and they have their own ideas about stuff. It was malak. Anyway, a short video clip, something culturally sensitive, interesting, funny, like Marshalette did. Practical application and probing questions. Come, ladies, what do you think? How do you feel about this? They have their own opinions. Plan to check for understanding. These are just the steps. Develop a conclusion and a preview. And create a realistic timeline. Sometimes we can't expect too much of ourselves. Sometimes we might touch on a topic and it will be much more interesting than maybe a little bit more as we go further in the book. Stay with it. If they are interested, they are listening, keep at it. There's no point if you're going to, I don't know, go quickly just to get to a certain exercise. I don't know if I'm making any sense. Okay, presenting the lesson plan. Letting your students know what they will be learning and doing in class that day will keep them more engaged and on track. Pique their interest, let them know. Prepare them. You can share your lesson plan by writing a brief agenda on the board or telling them explicitly what they will be learning and doing in class. Give them ideas before you begin. The other thing is you can do it the day before even. When you round up your class, you can explain to them, right ladies, this is what we're going to discuss. An exercise that I love to do is to throw a topic out there about the next day's class and say, find something interesting. My students had a misconception about journalists. I studied to be a journalist. That was my original profession, so to speak. I said, what do you know about journalists? Oh, they're selfish. They just like to be on TV. They just like to look good and stand there and present, and that's it. And I said, oh, interesting. Okay. So I said, right. Tomorrow we're going to do a whole topic on journalists, communication, media, all those aspects. And I said to them, they need to go home. Choose one journalist, it could be a male or a female. Interestingly, most of them chose women. And I actually asked them why. I said, because we can aspire to be like these women. And they chose, I said, choose a famous journalist, dead or alive, somebody that has done something great, or maybe somebody who is doing something great right now. And they did, and they gave presentations. And they were amazing. They spoke about a Lebanese woman who had spoken about some information that she wasn't supposed to leak for the good of a whole group of people. She was in a bomb blast. She lost an arm and a leg and an eye. But she stood up weeks after her recovery and said, I will not lie. I will fight for what I believe in. An amazing woman. And they spoke about a whole bunch of journalists that had done incredible things. And I said, right now, what do you think about journalists? Wow, miss, we had no idea. They are absolute heroes. And I said, yes. So they were so interested, and they wanted to continue talking. And
after you've planned your lesson, so talked about getting to know your students, bonding with them, understanding the challenges that they face, lesson planning at home. Now you're in the classroom. You made it all the way to the class. Now the board presentation, some things to write on the board every day. The date, the class subject, chapter, unit, page number, student objectives, student learning outcome, an outline of today's lesson, today's vocabulary, group assignment, homework, and maybe a smiley face and a welcome on there, okay? So you may need a huge board to get all of this on there, right? Very small.
And
no,
it's good to see you.
Right, the size so they can see it and it's comfortable for their eyes. So reflecting on your lesson plan.
Okay, so a lesson plan at some time, some stages may not work as well as you might hope. Okay, we're all human beings, even teachers are human beings. Right, a lesson plan may not work as well as you had expected due to a number of extraneous circumstances. Everybody has a bad day. Okay? Students have bad days, teachers have bad days. Sometimes you just have to wing it, sometimes it's just not working out the way you expect it, sometimes your activities fall flat. Don't get discouraged, it happens to even the most experienced teachers. But some days you have lessons and you walk out and you feel energized and alive, and you can see the light bulb go off. Wow, I understood that. Take a few minutes after each class to reflect on what worked well and why, what you could have done differently. Sometimes you'll do an activity and it's just sort of a blank stare. It didn't really work. It was kind of boring. The students didn't bite it, so to speak. Sometimes you do an activity which leaves the entire class energized. I did a debating session once about a topic in the textbook, separated the two sides of the classroom, and some of them had to actually fight for a cause. They didn't even believe it. But it helped them dig deeper and see things from a different perspective. Well, I was so impressed by what came out of their mouths. It was unbelievable. I was actually flabbergasted. And I saw, I mean, they said, Miss, we want to do it again. We want to do it again tomorrow. And I said, no. Can't be an everyday thing, but I was so impressed. It really was amazing. Then and so basically, what I'm trying to say is, a debating option leads to a lot of talking, research. They public speak. Everybody is given 1 minute to present their case. Each group was given some time to come up and sort of fight their final fight, and it incorporated a lot of speaking. Speech time, and it builds confidence as well, which I love to see. Even the girls that were the quietest, like, no, I want to talk now. And they would give their opinion. Take a few minutes after, identifying successful and less successful organization of class time and activities is very beneficial and helpful from future lessons. Learn from other teachers. Learn from your past mistakes. It helps to think, okay, I did that exercise, not again. But it's always, yeah, take the positive part with you. I'm gonna go to the next one.
Just click on the screen. Click on the screen, yeah.
Okay. Is this you?
Yes. Okay, so now we're going to talk about some ways to make learning fun. Thank you, Christina.
One more thing.
Okay. So some things that you can do while in the classroom to make things just more enjoyable for the students and yourself is to use humor and jokes, okay? Smile, praise students, compliment the students, good job, wow, nice earrings, nice shoes, are those new? Just small talk, give incentives. Okay, we may stop 5 minutes early today, depending on how well you do. We may start 5 minutes late tomorrow. Prizes, you will be amazed at how something so small as this can motivate the students to be on their best behavior, and it's funny. Okay, I have some expensive chocolate M&Ms. These came from Italy. No, teacher, Italy, really? Yes, Italian M&Ms, expensive. Now they're excited. They're they think it's funny because they know they didn't come from Italy. But at the end of the class, when I say, let's see who's that special student who's going to get these, you should see them backs up like me. Over this little M&M now. Seriously. And something smaller, a little piece of chocolate, a piece of gum.
Motivates them. Maybe.
Positive reinforcement. Don't embarrass them. Don't hurt their feelings. Sometimes, sure, you may have to put your foot down, but never in a nasty, cruel way. Always with love, even if it's tough love. Games. And we had Val, hopefully, would do something on games, the importance of games, because they do love games. They're fun, entertaining, and educational. Competitions. And surprise them. Surprise. Okay, let's talk about, have you ever wanted to do this? Learning is a better question, in my opinion. I also believe I will not judge you on your worst day. I won't. Everyone's entitled to have an off day. Everyone. I give them a clean slate. Every day they walk in that door, I've forgotten the bad and only remember the good to take forward. I'm human, but this is my approach. Coming is half the battle. Just for them to come through that door, I've already won. I've won half the battle in my approach. And I always let them know I'm glad that you came. And every day I'm going to get up and I'm going to teach them. Every day I'm going to get up and teach them. Here's some strategies that I use. I try to smile and I laugh even if it hurts. And the reason that I said that is because Jocelyn made a great point during the last presentation about being an actress, kind of. You should, in my opinion. Your problems don't belong in the classroom with the students. You may need to know their problems in order to help with the lesson and understand some things that may be taking place to affect the classroom, but I don't think they need to know your problems, and I'm angry, and this is going on. Also, some teachers scream if they're talking about, you know, trying to get their attention, or some people do the opposite, stand there silent for 5 minutes, and 5 minutes of class time is gone as you wait on them to get silent. I do neither of those. What I do is, I say, let's say it's a lot of talking, I say, raise your hand if you're talking. That's what I do. And they're usually laugh, because who wants to raise their hand to me? I'm doing something wrong. No one wants to. Raise your hand if you're talking. And they're like, because they know I'm telling them to raise their hand, but they know, why would I admit I'm doing something wrong? So usually it turns into a laughing thing, or but they get the point to stop. Just simple. That's my style. Also, I bring them little piece of chocolate, little piece of gum, little juice. You'll be amazed at how that motivates them. Let's say that I'm going to get some people to call on, and they're seeming a little apprehensive that day. I say, let me see who I should call on. Someone that's looking right at me. Everybody try to turn their head quickly, and who's there with the slowest gets called on. So it's a way of getting those shy students, but it's fair territory. Also, I may say, let's see who I should call on, someone who's not looking at me. Now, even the shy ones are looking at you. They don't want to, because they don't want you to call on, but they know the rules. I'm going to call on who's not looking at me, so they're even looking at you. And whoever breaks it gets called on. So those are just some of my strategies. I say, let's see who I should get to read. And I mean, this student is going to be a very special student. I mean, this is a special student who I'm going to call them now. This just makes them feel good. I also say, I'm proud of you. You are the best of the best of the best. After each lesson, I go around and I high-five them. And sometimes I move my hands and make them drop it. And one of my things that I do, if they answer a question correctly, I say, wow, genius. Teach me English. Come on, I'm going to go sit down. You come up here. That's how good your English is. Okay? Just motivational to let them know if you could teach a native, you're really doing good in improving your skills. Okay. The last part. In conclusion, to sum up, maintain a level of professionalism at all times. Christine helped phrase this one. Do not aim to be their friend, but someone who inspires them to be the best that they can be. Do not aim to be a dictator. You are not running an army. Rather be someone approachable, understanding, empathetic, and an ally. Even though the teacher and student are team players, each having a role, the students are not a sounding board for the teacher's issues. Keep your personal problems out of the classroom. And maintain an air of mystery. It keeps them coming back for more. And points to remember, classroom management is the accumulation of many things, not just one. It's starting with really getting to know your students, not just their level, major, nationality, but really getting to know them. Adjusting your approach when you discover it's not working. understanding the challenges facing ESL EFL teachers, preparing your lessons outside the classroom, board writing, making learning fun, teach the entire class time. Don't sweat the small stuff, focus on the big picture the next time those cell phones drive you crazy. And be thankful. They could have been anywhere in the world, but they chose to be in your classroom. Doesn't that count for something? And some quotes before we open up the floor. He who dares to teach must never cease to learn. Are you just teaching and refusing to learn from your students? Just things to ponder. The best teachers are those who show you where to look but don't tell you what to see. Are you showing your teachers where to look or are you telling them what to see? And the mediocre teacher tells, the good teacher explains, the superior teacher demonstrates, the great teacher inspires. Just some things to think about. Now, what do the researchers say? Do I look like I care? I'd rather hear from the real experts, the ones who are in the classroom day in and day out and know the challenges that we face. So now I'm going to open up the floor to all of you and let's discuss how do you deal with the common issues of cell phones. Do you ask them to raise their hand to leave out the class? How do you handle classroom management? Yes.
I think to the question of why does it bother you, is it because they're not learning? I think it bothers me because it makes me feel like I must not be engaging them well enough so that they're bored and they're going to do something.
It feels to me like they're being disrespectful to me and their classmates by not listening, by not being engaged.
And anyone that wants to come into the office.
It disrupts the flow of the class because if there's one girl who has an iPad, everybody else wants to see what she's doing. But as for the cell phone thing, if I ask, is it important? Step outside, no problem.
Mm-hmm.
No.
Can't.
Yeah, I actually don't ask if it's important because I think they're old enough, mature enough, where they know they're supposed to be in class, and so they usually just ask, can I take this outside, or I need to make a phone. I don't ask, this is important. I mean, you know, I'm sure they're not, I mean, they're aware. And the same thing goes for bathroom. I mean, they're grown-ups, that's how I look at it, and you want to use the bathroom, I'm not going to ask you, can you hold it, or is it necessary, or what are you going to do? No, it's just, yeah, go, and they come back.
Okay.
But, like, for the cell phone usage, mm-hmm. for me, it's not the talking, because they know to get out. It's the two or three people, exactly, sitting around and, like, either looking at a video or texting to each other. That's what's, and I think, for me, it's only when it doesn't bother me so much. It's when I see that it's really affecting the other students, and they won't say anything. So it's my place as a teacher to actually say, you need to put that away or whatever.
So Karen makes a good point. Sometimes it disrupts the other students. How do you deal with it, Terry?
Well, I know I missed some of what you said, but I think I know what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
When they have cell phone use in the class, I feel that sometimes it's like any other problem that's going on in the classroom. If you put too much emphasis on something, mm-hmm. that is in itself disruptive. The teacher can disrupt as much as the child when you're trying to, not child, but women, mm-hmm. when they're doing something you don't want them to do. Mm-hmm. So in my classroom, I can just look at them. They know, you know, if they've got it under here, we as teachers know when they're on something. Okay, so if they feel the need to hide it, you already know that they're not working on something for the class. So I've gotten to the point, they know when I look at them, oh, you know, it's automatic, you know, put it down. Don't spend a lot of time on that issue. If you feel that they're overusing something, you can speak to them quietly, maybe after class or something like that. That's the way that I handle it. I usually don't have many problems in that area if I handle it.
You can also maybe crack a joke, say, oh, you're looking up some English words, right? Tell them some of them. When they know that's not what they're doing, they put it up quickly. But go ahead and then Christina, last word.
Yeah, I just want to ask from teachers here, if you have a problem, like I have a couple students in my class that are always on their phone, and they're always texting, they're not paying attention, they're sitting in the back, so it's a constant interruption in the class, and like how do you deal with that? Like, do they know the rules?
Christy. And you know, I've had the same experience, and I actually said to the students, I'm a mother, so for me, having my cell phone nearby, on, in case something happens, I need to know. I have it next to me, they can see that I have it. So I don't expect them, who might have something going on in their lives, not to have their cell phones on them either. So what I always say to them is, ladies, I'm happy for it to be on your desk, but before the lesson, come and talk to me. Miss, my mom is in the hospital. Miss, you know, I might be expecting an emergency call. My father might. I say, absolutely fine. And if it happens, just get up quietly, go out of the classroom, take the call. But out of respect for me, ladies, if you wouldn't mind, just not fiddling on your phone mark. And I think sometimes even just having it on the desk next to them makes them feel a little bit more empowered. But just ask them very nicely. Don't text. If it's important, everyone has an emergency in their lives. Give them that
on Karen and Gaston.
I think maybe part of the problem is, in terms of how to deal with it, might be to actually preempt it, rather than trying to deal with it during the semester as, you know, day in, day out. And what I mean by that is, I mean, normally I think you have like a syllabus, which works as a contract between the student and the teacher. That's what the syllabus is. I mean, it gives you a breakdown of what will be covered, but there's a portion of it that explains the course and the rules. If you don't really tell the students in the beginning of the semester, day one, that these are the rules, this is, you know, this is the way the class, into the classroom, this is what I expect, this is, you know, what we're going to do, or if you get on your phone, you can expect, you know, if you're not using it to look at vocabulary or something class-related, that I will actually confiscate it, or whatever. You decide how you're going to deal with it before the semester begins. And you have to actually inform the students that these are the rules. So, during the semester when they're sitting there texting, you know, you don't need to talk about it. You just need to take
implement.
Yeah, exactly. And they understand, I mean, if the syllabus of they understand that if they remain in the class, that they are agreeing to actually abide by those rules. That's what the syllabus is. I mean, I unfortunately came in the middle of the semester. I wasn't able to do half of the stuff that I would have liked to do. But I come next semester, that's what I intend to do day one. You know, this is the way the class will, you know, these are the rules and, you know, whatever.
So any other, thank you, Karen, any other opinion, song?
I have the same students as Aya, so this is what I've noticed. I have this trust thing in my class. I trust you to use your phone for looking up the vocabulary or a dictionary or whatever, the Google Translate or whatever they need. And I can tell right away, hey, what are you doing with your phone? If they look up and they have a guilty expression on your face, I know right away that. And I just go like this and they hand it to me themselves. I never have to snatch it, I never have to ask for it. I just go like this.
And see, I would never take it though.
I take it and I give it back to them at the end of the class. But this rarely happens because they know that because I'm trusting them to use their phone to begin with.
They feel like they're disappointed.
Yeah, so they're using it as grown-ups. Now yeah. I also have the same students, the same problems, they're on their phone the whole time. So I've made a deal with them. They get the work finished and then I always have something extra for them because there are always going to be people who finish early. And if they finish that, and they sit quietly, they can tweet, they can do whatever they want, as long as they're not disturbing anybody else in the class. And the thing is, they all sit together, so as a group, they're not distracting anybody else. So, and since they're all like texting each other, they're not really making any sound. So that's just how I've managed to deal with it.
Yeah, I'm sort of the same way. I'm encouraging them to use their iPads and their cell phones for dictionaries.
A lot of people, you know.
And I just sort of monitor it. I just sort of watch them, and that's what they're doing.
You can always tell.
And they're sitting there, and they're writing.
Yeah.
And once in a while, I see two girls.
Yeah. Everybody's talking one time, so I can hear you. Everybody at one time. That's another technique. They didn't know I can't hear you.
Yeah. But and then if they're hiding it, then I go and look, and I say, put your cell phone away. Mm-hmm. You're not going to use it today because you're using it. that seldom happens. I see them sitting there, two girls writing the word down, spelling it to each other and stuff. It's all the time. The only restriction I have on the cell phones is I make them put their cell phone on my desk when they go out to the bathroom. They don't have to ask, they just put their cell phone on the desk and they go.
I just have a question that's not related to cell phone. How you deal with students, the problem with students speaking while you're speaking or speaking while a student is presenting, another student is presenting.
Exactly what I just did. That's what
yeah,
I do.
But
everybody on the count of three tell me to answer at one time what you're trying to say. And then they know they can't do that because I won't understand. So I'm doing it in a humorous way.
But
they get the point, you can't all speak at one time.
They're not talking, though, too. They're not saying the answer. They're talking to each other on the side there while you're trying to teach.
I would say raise your hand who's talking.
I do eyes on me. That is a technique that I used back when I was in China. So they all know when I say eyes on me and I give them a minute, they usually will calm down and they'll stop. And even my students now, who give up and give presentations, and the students are talking, they'll say, now, girls, eyes on me.
No, but when someone else is presenting.
Like, yeah, but when the student is presenting,
I
always say to that student, sorry, just stop for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
And then,
yeah,
you wait,
mm-hmm.
And then they immediately
yeah.
go, oh, that, and then I say, okay, you can continue now.
That's what I say. So,
you
I'm sorry,
are
we interrupting your conversation? We're sorry.
Just make them carry on. Finish.
Okay.
I have a question for you. When we observed you, there wasn't one student who had her cell phone. So how did you create that balance?
We told them we had somebody come in. If they did not follow the rules, they were going to get it when it was all
yeah,
over.
No,
with.
No,
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 I'm being serious.
I have a feeling they don't bring out their cell phones.
Sometimes it just becomes a respect issue. That's really,
yeah.
And that's why I gave the five pillars. I don't know it all. Please, I'm looking forward to everyone else's presentation so we can put it all together and become the best that we can be. But for some reason, it just works because I don't sweat the small stuff. I'm thinking they came through the door. How special is that they came? They could have stayed at home. They could have dropped out. Anything could have happened. Just them coming to me, I've already won as a teacher. Now, getting to come back another day, I just see the big picture and not the small cell phone. Like, oh my gosh, she's drinking. She doesn't respect me. I just think sometimes teachers go on that power trip. And that's why I failed as a teacher, which almost got me out of teaching ever again. And I realized you don't have to go in there like that. That attitude stresses you out, your whole body. It makes learning not fun. They don't remember you as a good teacher. I'm just now more laid back and relaxed. And it works for me. It works for me. Terry and
you. You made a very good point when we were going doing the presentation together. She said, I let them have a little piece of chocolate or a juice on their table or their water or a little something to eat because how do we feel when we're hungry and tired?
Sometimes they...
Our blood sugar levels drop.
Yeah,
we can't concentrate.
About the food.
No, me neither. And then they'll open a packet of chips and they'll sort of hide it. And I go, ladies,
just eat.
When I'm hungry, I
should and then put the
exactly.
door away. I mean, because sometimes I'm hungry. Sometimes I'm weak. Just yesterday I was so weak I could have fainted. My point is... Should I make them out of respect and authority, wait 1 hour and 30 minutes, or should I let them quickly take 5 minutes, eat your chocolate, and let's get back focused? And now we've built a respect between each other that I understand, I get it.
Mm-hmm. At PMU, I used to give my students my office key. If I saw one of them was a little bit recess, I'd run to my office, there's a bunch of bananas on my desk. Seriously, and they'd run, they'd grab a banana, and they'd sit there munching away, and I said, do you feel better now? Oh, so much better, thank you, miss. It helped.
And then I had a student coming late a lot, and how I handled her, and she never came back late again. One day she came early, and I said, wow, Eshra, you are here early. What are you doing here at this time? You're not supposed to be here for another 15, 20 minutes. And then the whole class turned around, and she's like, and she started coming on time then. I feel like if I had handled, what are you doing late? You're disrespecting my class. You know, it's just not necessary, and I think sometimes that we stress ourselves out and put too much unnecessary stress, especially on ESL students when they're already fluent in their first language and picking up a second one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I think with lateness, I mean, maybe I'm too lenient as well when it comes to that. Sometimes there are reasons for that. I mean, I'm not making excuses for them, but I don't get on their cases for that. But there's a student who was late, like you said, 15, 20 minutes every day, sometimes half hour. And, you know, after class, I just spoke to her and said, you know, I'm really concerned about, like, your lateness, that, you know, I don't know too much about the rules here, but I know a lot of times a lot of universities, it adds up, like, a certain amount of lateness is equals an absence, you know, maybe is it the same thing here, and what's going on? So just me, you know, pulling her aside and actually speaking to her, she told me it's the driver, they have to take her little brother here, you know, and then, but let me tell you, I didn't say anything to her, like, you know, don't come in late, nothing. And then after that, she was on time.
I had also the same problem with latecomers, and I designed a little classes. So if you're late, as you enter the class, there's this paper waiting for you, and you write your name and you write your time. And if there's a pattern, if you repeated this thing, clearly, you know, it's their evidence, and you take ownership of that late coming. If it was a student who did it maybe just once or twice, maybe there's a reason for it. But those who continue doing the same thing, within 2 weeks, it stopped, and people came on time. To a point that I didn't need to leave the latecomers sheet out in the front of the classroom. They just took ownership of their own late coming, and it stopped.
That's a good idea. Because sometimes I have a hard time because I follow the rules. You were told the rules when you got here, so
yeah. And I didn't speak about late coming. You know, initially this was the rules. These are the rules. It was spoken about. It was discussed. And then when I realized there was this pattern, I just left it out there for them to take ownership of your own late coming. Mm-hmm. So of course, you know, after
that's
several late coming, you have been, how many absences already reflected on the attendance sheet.
Any other thoughts on anything related to the things that we have to go through in the classroom? But you are truly the experts, really.
I was wondering if you could share also what you do every day with the vocabulary.
Oh, that's just, that would take another 2 hours.
No, it would not. No, when you had the vocabulary on the board,
yes.
And you would point to it, and they did something automatically.
Well, they know that at the end of each lesson we go over the vocabulary that we did that day, so it's just embedded with the board work. When I say have the vocabulary up there, after you finish teaching, go over it. What's this one, what's that one, what's this one?
They explain the meaning of
it? They have to give you a definition and an example.
And they do it like clockwork.
Yeah.
So it's something that they've done, I assume, every day.
Yeah, we do.
Yeah.
Any other thoughts? Are you going to smash that cell phone with that type of student? Don't do that itself. I don't think it'll work.
No,
okay. Thank you, ladies.